medical aspect to your cinema, to your kind of movie making, to the and I think that you spoke about it in a kind of in terms of the cords and all the cables and things that are involved with filmmaking, but then also in the way that you actually approach movie making. And I was wondering if you could just talk about that a little bit in relation to this film.
Gracias. Voy a hablar en español. No, me parece a mí que el aspecto médico, en todo caso, que puede haber en relación en mi caso, con hacer cine, es esos intentos de aproximación microscópica y de, a partir de eso, intentar sacar conclusiones generales sobre el cuerpo, ¿no? Que es un poco lo que hacen los médicos.
So I'm going to speak Spanish and I'm going to be translated. So I think that the medical aspect in my filmmaking is the fact that I try to get as close as possible to my subject in almost a microscopical way, and from that to draw more general conclusions or reflections, which is what doctors tend to do.
Eso de una manera un poco, lo digo sarcástica, ¿no? No creo que en eso consista la medicina.
Well, of course, it's a sarcastic remark. I don't think that that's what medicine is.
Pero existe, es eso y también todo el set de filmación de alguna manera se transforma en una especie de lugar de chequeos médicos, no de médicos, sino un set de filmación se podría parecer perfectamente a un lugar donde se toman radiografías o donde se hace, ¿cómo se llama eso que te ponen una cosa y van haciendo fotos? Bueno, tomografías, esas cosas.
Well, on saying this, what I want to say is that somehow the set of a film can be similar to a doctor's office or a radiologist's office, where there's X-rays taken, or even CAT scans, where images are made of a person's body.
Y todos esos dispositivos técnicos, todos esos intentos de aproximación, intentan develar algo que finalmente es un misterio, ¿no? Que es la vida. Y a mí me parece eso, que en ese punto se parecen. Es una cantidad de dispositivos narrativos, de dispositivos técnicos, para intentar acercarse a algo que en definitiva es extremadamente misterioso.
So all these technical aspects are all things or devices that allow us to come closer and closer to finding out or putting out there a mystery of something which is, well, by nature very secret and mysterious, and that's life itself. So that's what I mean. We use all these technical devices to try to bring to light something that deep down is still very mysterious.
This is an observation about the importance of water in The Headless Woman and in The Holy Girl, in La Cienega too, when you see it. And a question about the scene where Maria Oneto hops into the shower with all of her clothes on. Why does she do it? Is it, is she trying to get the scent of her encounter with her lover off of her, or is there another more mysterious reason?
En verdad nunca pensé en el agua como algo simbólico ni demasiado particular. Me parece que en el norte de Argentina, de donde yo soy, Salta, donde filmé estas tres películas, llueve en el verano y en el invierno es una estación muy seca. Y eso hace que el ciclo del agua sea muy particular. Uno presta atención porque las tormentas son subtropicales y muy fuertes, pero más allá de eso no hay una intención simbólica ni nada de eso en la película. Creo que uno cuando se siente a veces mal, el cuerpo se enfría y a veces necesita meterse en la ducha, pero No pensé nada simbólico en torno a eso.
Well, actually, I never thought that water could be used as a symbol or something special. Actually, what happens is that in the north of Argentina, where I come from, in the Salta area, which is where my three long films were shot and set, it rains in the summer a lot, whereas winters are very dry. So in a way, the water fall cycle over there is different than what you're used to. And, you know, we're used to subtropical storms almost. So yeah, that's maybe the only element there, but I never set out to attach a symbolic meaning to any of that. So that's basically the bottom line. What I could say is that, you know, sometimes when one doesn't feel well, is not good in his own or her own skin, well, they tend to get cold, and so they want to hop into the shower to warm up. That's all there is to it.
This is a question about the style of the film, the shooting style, really also the structure of the film, the lack of establishing shots, and also the elliptical nature of the narrative. So it's a general question about to Lucrecia about whether she can discuss that.
Para mí, la gramática del cine tiene algo muy interesante, que es la aproximación que los elementos narrativos con los que uno cuenta en una para hacer una película, a mí me resultan muy próximos a cómo funciona la memoria, o al menos las observaciones que yo he hecho sobre mí misma y sobre la memoria.
As far as I'm concerned, when I talk about the grammar of cinema, there's something interesting in it, which is how close narrative elements are to the way actual memory works, or at least the way my memory works, you know, what I've observed about what happens to me.
Y para mí la memoria es un procedimiento emotivo emotivo y narrativo. Y cuando uno recuerda una escena o algo que le ha sucedido, no recuerda escenas de transición ni tomas de establecimiento. Son más directamente cuestiones emotivas que van conformando el recuerdo. A mí me parece que no hay necesidad para este tipo de películas de ser explicativo en términos de dónde estamos, hacia dónde vamos, el tiempo está pasando. Me parece que el movimiento mismo de la película no necesita de eso. Yo entiendo que otras películas lo necesitan, pero a mí, de la forma que yo trabajo con el montaje, me resulta innecesario.
Well, when you, I believe that memory is very emotional and narrative process. So when somebody remembers something, you know, they just remember the thing. They don't remember a transitional element. They don't remember an establishing shot. They just remember the issue itself. So I believe that that's the way memory works. So in this type of film, the type of film I make, I believe that I have no need to explain where characters come from, where they're going, how time flows. I just need to convey what they're feeling. And I do know that there's other styles of films that require those other devices, but mine, I believe, does not.
It's a question about memory and cinema, and how in this particular festival there have been a lot of evocations of memory and a lot of films that have dealt with memory. And the question to Lucrecia is, does she feel that cinema is becoming something like the world's collective memory?
A mí me parece que particularmente, voy a contestarlo de una manera muy regional y particular desde mi país, ¿no? Yo pertenezco a una generación que empieza a producir narrativa, en este caso audiovisual, después de un periodo muy tremendo político que fue la dictadura. Lo que una dictadura hace en un país no es solamente, por supuesto, hacer desaparecer a 30.000 personas, entre las que hubo muchísimos artistas y directores de cine y gente que era de la cultura. No solamente hace eso, sino genera una cortes en el organismo de la sociedad, genera una degradación del funcionamiento de la sociedad como organismo.
Well, I think I'm going to provide an answer that's very regional in nature. It's really based on my experience in my country of origin. I come from a generation of Argentine directors who are starting to produce stories, to tell stories or make films, in my case, after a long period of dictatorship. And what a dictatorship does to a country is not only, to have over 30,000 people disappear, among which, artists and filmmakers, of course, but it's really to create a cut, a degradation in the texture of society itself.
Y el cine, mi experiencia es que el cine permite reconstruir eso que en gran parte es la renuncia al olvido, y eso es la memoria. Es no conformarse con los grandes agujeros negros de la historia, ¿no? Y para mí ese trabajo, esa función de alguna manera que cumple el cine, la literatura, permite otra vez volver a hacer la sutura en el tejido de la sociedad. Nos permite otra vez ser una comunidad. Me parece a mí que si el cine es la memoria de la humanidad, es posible. Y si ahora hay muchos subrayados acerca de la memoria, es porque quizás hay algo muy degradado en nuestra humanidad como comunidad, ¿no? Hay algo que se ha degradado y que evidentemente necesitamos de alguna forma reconstruir.
Yes, cinema in my experience actually allows us to reconstruct or to place back together all that had been destroyed before. In a way, it's our form or our way to say no, to forgive, to forgetting things, to putting, to blacking out things. It's our way not to accept the black holes that were created in our history. So this is actually I believe what cinema and literature need to set out to do. They actually need to sew back, to create a suture in the break and all the disintegration in the social texture, and it allow us to rebuild a community which had been lost. So yes, in a way, cinema can be our collective memory, because I believe that all over the world there's something that has undergone a degradation, and we need to work on rebuilding what has been disintegrated.
A question about Lucrecia's style, and which is indeed very distinctive. And the question is, has she found inspiration in the work of any other filmmakers in the development of that style?
Quizás también por donde nací yo, no tuve una cultura muy cinéfila, porque no había más que un cinearte que de vez en cuando funcionaba, y la verdad que yo no estaba muy al tanto de su funcionamiento, pero lo que a mí me acercó al cine y lo que me mantiene definitivamente en el cine es haber experimentado durante muchísimos años los relatos de mi abuela, las conversaciones. Yo siento mi cine muy deudor del habla, de la conversación, de las visitas a los enfermos, muy deudor de todas las escenas de narración oral.
Actually, maybe for where I was born and I grew up, I really did not have that much of a cinematic culture. Like, I didn't tend to go to the movies much. We just had a small cinema, and I didn't tend to go that much. But what actually drew me to cinema and keeps me in it is probably the oral storytelling that I was exposed to a great deal. I'm thinking of all the stories that were told by my grandma, all the, you know, conversations that among adults that I kept hearing. For example, you know, sitting by a bed of somebody who's sick and telling stories. So that's the type of storytelling that I'm familiar with and that I love.
Y hay cosas muy concretas que uno puede observar en una conversación. Te doy un ejemplo, una escena. Cuando muchas veces yo iba con mi abuela a visitar amigas de ellas que estaban enfermas. Muchas veces no se sabía de qué enfermedad eran, se habían recluido en sus habitaciones. Y yo era chica, entonces iba, me sentaba y sencillamente escuchaba cómo estas mujeres conversaban de una cosa, de la otra, iban y venían. Y hay muchas observaciones que ya como desde uno muy chico puede ver en esa situación. Por ejemplo, que el tiempo y el espacio se disuelven. Cuando dos personas conversan muy entregadas a la conversación, el tiempo y el espacio se disuelve y ya las personas no tienen siquiera una identidad tan precisa, ya no tienen una edad precisa, no tienen una entidad precisa, porque cuando uno habla, la posibilidad de usar verbos en pasado, en presente, en futuro, hace que la persona se disuelva. Y esa observación esa observación hecha desde bastante chica y perfeccionada con el tiempo ha sido para mí la base fundamental de construcción narrativa.
I'm going to tell you about a specific example. I remember very clearly that when I was growing up, when I was a little girl, I used to go together with my grandma to visit some friends of hers who were sick. They were bedridden. And, I was a little girl, and I would just sit around and just listen. And, there was a lot already that I could pick up on, that I could observe, even though I was just a little girl. And one thing that I immediately noticed is that somehow when people are talking to each other and they're really engaged in that conversation, the boundaries of time and space kind of tend to get lost, to intermix, and they just, it's as if they faded away. So people themselves kind of lose their identity. It's as if they had no specific age, because when people speak, they can use different verb tenses. They can talk about it in the future, in the present, in the past. So actually, there's no precise limits. There's no boundaries. Everything kind of fades away. And this observation that, I made when I was a little girl first, and then I continued to work on and elaborate on, is really the starting point for my filmmaking and my technique.
Y respecto, perdón, una cosa más. Si uno tiene muy presente, clara, la escena sonora, el concepto sonoro de una escena, es inevitable filmar, usar menos película, lo cual en Argentina, por supuesto, es muy conveniente porque es más barato, es mejor filmar menos. Si uno tiene muy claro el concepto sonoro de una película, el uso de la imagen se vuelve mucho más austero y más preciso, me parece a mí.
So actually, another thing I want to add is that if one has very clear in their mind the sound of a scene, it becomes inevitable that you tend to film in a much in a sort of stricter, more austere, more essential way. And that's, you end up filming using up less film itself, which for me in Argentina is very important because, of course, film is very expensive. So I like to just shoot what really matters. And that's what happens.
So in other words, you begin with a sense of how a scene is going to sound, with the ambient sound of any scene.
Sí, el sonido, lo que tiene, lo que permite el sonido es que la, me parece que la capacidad que tiene una persona de distinguir los sonidos que se superponen es muchísimo mayor que la que tiene de distinguir imágenes que se superponen.
Yeah, I believe that people's abilities to distinguish between intertwined sounds is much greater than the ability to distinguish between intertwined images.
Por eso la construcción del espacio off en una escena es el sonido nos permite una cantidad de información que si intentáramos hacerlo a través de la imagen habría que hacer muchísimas tomas y muchísimos movimientos de cámara.
So basically, sound allows us to convey an enormous quantity of information. If we needed to convey that amount of information through scenes, through images, we would need to take a lot more shots and a lot more frames and scenes and set it up. Sound just allows you to do it.
The question is, did Lucrecia see the film Death of a Cyclist by Juan Antonio Bardem and at what age? Because she sees a lot of similarities between this film and that one.
La vi después que le había dado el guión a la productora, porque cuando la productora lo leyó me dijo que le recordaba a la muerte de un, la muerte de un viajante. La muerte de un ciclista.
I actually watched it after that I gave the script to the producer because the producer actually mentioned that she had the same feeling, so then I went and watched it.
Pero no me sorprende en absoluto. Me parece que los temas de ambas películas, en el caso de la película española, está más orientado hacia la moral. En el caso de mi película, no está orientado hacia la moral, la crítica. Pero no me sorprende en absoluto. Me parece que son preocupaciones tan esenciales, humanas, que...
I'm not surprised that you see this similarity because that both films deal with similar issues. I believe the Spanish film is more focused on moral type of observations. In my case, it's much less so. But you know, we both deal with issues that are so relevant today that it's just only normal that you see that.
It's a question about Maria Onetto the particular qualities that she brings to this role and how Lucrecia got her to give this performance. Is this her first film?
Es su primer protagónico.
The question was yes, for the for the main character, for the main actress, it was her first her first film as a protagonist.
Lo que María, cuando yo busqué la protagonista para esta película, tuve entrevistas con muchísimas actrices. Esta actriz es muy misteriosa, ella personalmente. Es una persona muy poco... es una persona que no reacciona de las maneras obvias. Tiene, naturalmente, en una conversación, en un restaurante, es muy misteriosa y no intenta ser complaciente, no tiene ninguna preocupación acerca de si se ve bien o se ve mal. Es una persona que cuando se enfrenta a la escena no le preocupa en absoluto ni el ridículo, ni si está bella o no está bella. Es una actriz muy excepcional en ese sentido. Y además es una actriz cuyo cuerpo es muy alta, es alta, es muy blanca. Y para mí esas características físicas eran importantes en el film. Alguien que había cometido un hecho del que quería escapar y cuyo cuerpo era difícil de esconder, me parecía que era importante, porque en el norte la población tiene mucho de aborigen y es más bien baja en una gran porcentaje, ¿no? Entonces me parecía que esta mujer evidente físicamente y además de todo su misterio y su excelencia como actriz, me parecía que era ideal para el personaje.
Well, when I was casting for this role, I saw a huge number of actresses. When I came across Maria, she was she's immediately mysterious. Actually, I'm just talking about just talking to her in a restaurant. Her way of dealing with people is so different than what you're used to. She doesn't really try in any way to be liked. She doesn't worry about whether she looks good or not, whether what people think of her. That's her personally, not even as an actress. I was so impressed by how she just doesn't care whether people find her good looking or not good looking, if she looks ridiculous. She just has this mysterious attitude about her. So that's something that I liked. And also her physical features. She's very tall and she's very white. And that was important to me because, you know, when I was trying to have somebody who's, you may or may not have committed a crime and is trying to hide from that, you know, with that kind of body, it would have been very difficult to hide because in that area of Argentina, people tend to be, you know, short and dark. And so even physically, she would just stand out. And so this physicality of her was also another interesting feature for me in casting her.
Y el pelo de María sí era un pequeño, pequeñísimo homenaje a Kim Novak en Vértigo.
And her hairstyle was a tribute to Kim Novak. The question is, how did you work with the actress in terms of handling the constant tension she's under throughout the, you know, the film?
María, cuando llegaba a la escena, bueno, en el cine siempre se filma tan desordenadamente, María tenía perfectamente memoria de lo que había hecho antes y después. Muchas veces me ayudaba a mí y me corregía en qué precisas situaciones ya estaba. Y después el gran secreto para trabajar con los actores es saber conversar con ellos y ellos saber conversar conmigo. En verdad no hay... La única cosa que yo intento que no suceda en el set con nadie en particular, pero especialmente con los actores, es no entrar en ninguna de esas cosas de sadomasoquismo que de las que hay tantas leyendas en el cine, porque me parece una actividad tan pequeño burguesa que no merece que nadie sufra por eso. Así que lo manejábamos con conversaciones muy amables y muy sencillas. Y yo contaba con su enorme sensibilidad y memoria acerca del punto en el que estaba en la película.
Well, whenever we were getting ready to shoot, actually, María, you know, we didn't shoot in sequence, and María always remembered extremely well what she'd just filmed before or what was coming later. So she had a great memory, and to the point that she even corrected me about that. She would, you know, she would remind me what we'd just done. And I believe that the secret in terms of dealing with actors, well, with anybody in your crew, but in particular with actors, is to be able to talk to them, you know, to be able to have open conversations, to listen to them, to take in what they have to say. The only thing that I actually try to avoid is to use that kind of sadistic and masochistic attitude that you know can take place on a set. And there's so many sort of story, you know, horror stories about that in the film industry. I believe it's such a small bourgeois attitude that, you know, I believe it's not necessary in the least. So actually, my main point is to keep the conversation going, to keep talking, and you know, in a very kind way on both ways. And In the specific case of María, I could count on her incredible sensitivity and memory, and that helped a lot.
We have to wrap it up, and I want to thank you all for coming, and thank you, Lucrecia.
Thanks.